impression on more and more people as of late. The group, which has one of the most strikingly creepy videos ever in Closer, won a Best Metal Grammy last year and nearly stole the show at Woodstock 94 with its mud-covered set.
Trent Reznor has managed to release a Nine Inch Nails album, The Downward Spiral, which surprised Trent and everyone by debuting at number 2 on the album charts.
I realized that it wasn't going to be a big commercial success type record. There wasn't any real singles on there. And it worked as a chunk of art, I thought, but not so much as... Someone say, let me hear something off your new record.
Nine Inch Nails' The Downward Spiral is an album that has only become more relevant as it's aged. A dark and brooding record from start to finish, reveling in the deepest trenches of emotional and mental anguish. It's a modern classic at this point, and I'd wager most of you have heard of this album at some point in your life, and if you've given it a listen, you already know why. The Downward Spiral deserves every bit of praise that it's gotten, and will go down in history as one of the most important records ever made. But with that being said, it's an album most seem to misinterpret, and if you take it at face value, it's easy to see why. The record is deeply nihilistic and depraved, exploring the fragmented and troubled mind of an addict who chooses to handle his vices with apathy and hedonism, only to find that in the end, it brought the destruction of all he had and a path that offers no real freedom, only pain, depravity, and decay. Most people listen to this record and all they hear is the praise and embrace of nihilism. But to me, I hear a warning. A record that explores the dark reaches of living life on the path of decadence and does its best to portray to you the horrors of embracing that road. To me, The Downward Spiral is an allegory for the anti-nihilist. So, let's talk about it.
Does Nine Inch Nails exist? Yes, it does exist.
Nine Inch Nails is no stranger to controversy, and in their early days, it was their main selling point. The Downward Spiral was the second full-length album from the band, and their fourth official release. During the 5-year gap between their debut and Downward, the band had already had a pretty tumultuous career, starting life as an edgy synth-pop-focused industrial band, singing melancholic lyrics of lust, atheism, and self-hatred. When Pretty Hate Machine first hit the market, it was a commercial success, hitting up to number 75 on the Billboard Top 200. This commercial breakout led to Reznor being seen as an up-and-coming star, but it didn't take long for issues to spring up. The band was originally signed to TVT Records, originally specializing in releasing songs featured in television shows. Signing Nine Inch Nails was one of their first forays into the commercial music world, so when they saw Pretty Hate Machine become incredibly popular in the underground and even enjoy some moderate mainstream success, the label began to force Reznor to make more commercially viable music, wanting the band to become the new Depeche Mode. Obviously, Reznor reacted about as well as you would expect. And began retaliating against the label, working on an EP under different aliases to avoid getting in trouble with his contract, writing what would later become the heaviest release from the band, Broken. An industrial metal EP that saw almost all the synth pop and commercial elements of the band disappear, with the entire EP being a massive middle finger to TVT Records. And surprisingly, this ended up being a win for them, getting off of their contract, all while building an even bigger fan base and gaining even more respect from the underground. I mean, Broken was such a success that they even got a Grammy for the song that included the lyric, "Fist Fuck." While the stories behind both Pretty Hate Machine and Broken will get their own videos at some point, I bring them up to give context to what Reznor was experiencing at the time, having all his work taken away from him and his dreams of becoming a rock star turning into an absolute nightmare. Around this same time, Reznor was a party animal and began using various drugs and quickly became a bit of an addict. To add even more fuel to the flames, Trent bought the infamous Tate Murder House in LA, the home where the Manson family killed Sharon Tate.
You guys find out you have to go visit Trent at the Manson house, where the Manson, or actually the Tate house where the Manson murders took place. How did that make you feel?
Well, It's something that if you just think it's really weird, it's weird. But if you don't think about it, it's fine. You know?
Any ghosts?
At first living here was a bit weird, because I live there too. I live out in the guest house where the caretaker was and didn't hear anything. So I feel safe. But the thing was, we drove cross country to get out here and knew what we were getting, you know, knew where we were going to be living. So we just took turns reading Helter Skelter out loud as we were driving. So we pull in here, 11 o'clock Sunday night, caretaker's like, here's your keys, see you in the morning.
While this might be in horrifically bad taste, turning the Manson family Fun Times mansion into a studio ended up being a genius move on Trent's part. It boosted his mystique to the audience, as well as brought a bit of controversy to his name, getting a lot of people who previously wouldn't have known him to pay attention. And with someone as meticulous as Reznor, I think it's fair to say that many of the great records that were recorded in that studio wouldn't have been the same if they were done somewhere else.
When I started working on Downward Spiral, I kind of approached it as a big chunk of work rather than 10 songs that just happened to be written at the same time.
The Downward Spiral starts off with a fast, loud, and oppressive song, Mr. Self-Destruct. A track that not only sets the mood of the record, but instantly shows off the deeply nihilistic and intense experience you're getting into. Not exactly easy listening material, and the lyrics by no means lighten the mood. I take you where you want to go. I give you all you need to know. I drag you down, I use you up, Mr. Self-Destruct. The lyrics speak as if they're the devil on your shoulder, or even a negative conscience, a constant taunting force holding all your sins and negative desires above your head. Something I imagine a struggling addict hears in their head as they struggle every day, denying themselves of another fix. The most telling part of the song is its quiet bridge, where the voice continues to taunt us, but another voice can be heard in the background, calling itself an insect. Showing off not only the temptation, but the blatant self-hatred the album is channeling. Piggy, on the other hand, is the opposite of Mr. Self-Destruct. Hey, big, piggy, big, big, big. All of my fears came. Showing off a calmer and more subtle musical and lyrical style. Trent sings about someone he calls Piggy in an accusatory tone about how they needed more and left Trent hurt and alone. It's theorized the song is actually about former guitarist and Filter frontman Richard Patrick, as his nickname was Piggy during his time with Nine Inch Nails. Though during the heat of the TVT Records feud and the uncertainty of Nine Inch Nails' future, Patrick left the band to pursue a career with his own band Filter, leading to a long feud between himself and Trent.
Black and blue and broken bones, you left me here, I'm all alone. My little piggy needed something new.
As you can hear, it's pretty clear what is being referenced. In terms of the theming of the album, it plays into the desperation of our narrator, distraught and desperate after losing someone close to him, whether that was caused by his own self-destructive actions or circumstances surrounding him. Although, when we reach Heresy, we see one of the most blatant examples of just how outwardly nihilistic Trent has become. The track is an all-out condemnation of religion, where Reznor proudly proclaims that he'll see us in hell if it exists. While most would just view it as an edgy song taking a creamy shit on the Bible, I think it's a bit deeper than that. Trent isn't just an atheist, but shows us he's an apatheist. For those who are out of the loop, an apatheist is someone who doesn't just not believe in God, but is just apathetic and doesn't care. accepting that they would rather burn in hell if it exists than deny themselves their pleasure or desires. And while apathy and nihilism are far from the same thing, they are closely related. And out of the many moments of apathy on this record, I think this is its most blatant one. And we all know how Plato felt about apathy. Up next comes March of the Pigs, a much different affair, however. It's a song that criticizes the society Trent saw around him of fake people constantly wearing masks to hide who they truly were.
All the pigs are all lined up. I give you all that you want. Take the skin and peel it back. Now doesn't it make you feel better?
This song can also be looked at a bit differently, possibly how Trent is acknowledging that others enjoy it when he spills his insecurities, sins, and dark thoughts, metaphorically peeling his skin back to show his true self, something many artists have experienced but seldom do they address, but with Reznor, well, this clip speaks for itself.
Sometimes someone will come up to me and say, you know exactly how I feel, you know, and you've been able to express it for me. And that's a cool feeling. That's the best compliment you could ever get.
And now we've reached the big boy of the record, the infamous Closer. One of the most genius bait-and-switch songs ever written. Known for its vulgar lyrics about fucking, the song is actually much deeper than that. The lyrics match the music in the sense that on the surface it's a groovy sex anthem, but once you begin to peel back the top layer, it shows off a deep dissonance and pain that would fly over the heads of those not paying attention.
You can have my isolation. You can have the hate that it brings. You can have my absence of faith. You can have my everything. You tear down my reason. It's your sex I can smell. You make me perfect. Help me become somebody else.
The entire song is just a confession of misery where Trent exposes that sex is just a coping mechanism he abuses to run from the emptiness that he feels, exposing that his lust is fueled less by his libido and more out of desperation to feel anything but the hatred and pain that radiates through his life. Up next comes Ruiner, a track that Reznor infamously hates, but I love. This is a song where apathy begins to turn to desperation, as the brevity of Trent's situation is setting in. Using the character of the Ruiner, or a metaphor used to describe both the negative forces that shape society, as well as the Jungian concept of the shadow self, which is the manifestation of the most negative and toxic aspect of ourselves that contrast our ideal self of ego.
He's got nothing to lose, and now he made you believe. The Ruiner's your only friend. Well, he's the living end to the cattle he deceives. The raping of the innocent, you know the Ruiner ruins everything he sees. Now the only pure thing left in my fucking world is wearing your disease.
This all quickly turns into self-deprecation when Trent talks about just how big this shadow has become.
How do you get so big? How do you get so strong? How do you get so hard? How do you get so long? And what you gave to me, my perfect ring of scars.
Ruiner also happens to be one of the album's most creative songs, with constant transitions and shift in sound, tone, and style. The theme of the shadow is expanded upon in the next track, The Becoming, a song that explores a topic in a more direct way as Trent talks about being turned into a machine, no longer being the man that those around him knew. The Becoming is a song built on emotional brokenness, with references to heroin scars, loss of emotion, and feeling completely broken. Showing the apathetic nihilism of the first half of the record transition into a desperate cry for help as Trent continues to devolve and suffer, wanting desperately to escape the pain and suffering of his circumstance, but being powerless to evade it and find any real purpose.
I can try to get away, but I've strapped myself in. I can try to scratch away the sound in my ears. I can see it killing away all of my bad parts. I don't want to listen, but it's all too clear.
If Ruiner and The Becoming were a cry for help, I Do Not Want This is an outright rejection of it. On this track, Reznor uses his verses to explain how he doesn't want to be the depressing husk that he's become. Yet in the choruses, he screams about not wanting to be told how he feels, something that can be construed as the protagonist being angry at those who don't understand his situation. But if we look at it in the greater context of the record, it comes across as the rejection many addicts react with to those who desperately want to help them get clean. This is where the previously mentioned nihilism of the record takes a chokehold, and Reznor's previous denial turned cry for help now transforms into outright self-destruction and suicidality. And no track makes this more apparent than the infamous song, Big Man with a Gun. The track is comical in how over the top it is. This is probably where the album gets closest to just outright schizo posting, with Trent talking about having a gun and a massive cock, talking about blowing holes in people's heads and coming on them. And before you ask, it's not meant to be taken seriously. Reznor would go on to say that he wrote the song as a response and mockery to the quote-unquote misogynistic gangsta rap bullshit.
Damn, that bitch is bad. Oh yeah.
Despite the irony of the song, Big Man with a Gun is actually quite fitting, as it explores the mentality of someone who has truly given up on any meaning or purpose in their lives, and embraces their most primal urges of sex and violence. It's after this where the album takes a reprieve with the song A Warm Place, an ambient instrumental that simply sets the mood for its closing tracks. Though, if I'm being honest, I usually skip this one, as it does little to add to the record's overall quality and story. In fact, the next song, Eraser, does a much better job at this, as it's mostly an instrumental, playing on a calm but unsettling tone that becomes more tense as it plays. Ending with the track becoming extremely intense as Trent screams about wanting to be killed. It's here where we reach my personal favorite song off the record, Reptile. Reptile is a track that has earned its legendary status. It's a slow and heavy song with an extremely thick atmosphere.
She spreads herself wide open to let the insects in. She leaves a trail of honey to show me where she's been. She has the blood of a reptile just underneath her skin. Seeds from a thousand others drip down from within.
Reptile's first verse paints a pretty ugly picture of a promiscuous woman, describing her beauty and sexuality as honey, and the men who flock to her as insects, a degrading depiction of those who indulge in sexual promiscuity, only for Trent to turn this on himself in the second verse.
Devils speak of the way in which she'll manifest. Angels bleed from the tainted touch of my caress. Need to contaminate to alleviate this loneliness. I know the depths I reach are limitless.
Trent describes his own promiscuity as something that makes angels bleed, and an endless pit he is continually sinking in. And in the song's chorus, everything comes together. The song is one of the album's most powerful, taking a topic that would typically come across as preachy and moralistic, but here it comes across as a heartfelt confession of one's own vice that is slowly eating them from the inside out. Before we hit the finale, we get the album's title track, another song that is mostly comprised of a calm instrumental that slowly progresses into a dysphoric nightmare, before jumping into a loud and intense crescendo of noise, screaming, and self-hatred. And while this song sees Trent yet again talk about taking a gun to himself and how easy it is to take his own life, the most telling section is actually the second verse, obscured by distortion and vocal effects.
Everything's blue. Everything's blue in this world. The deepest shade of mushroom blue. All fuzzy, spilling out of my head.
Hurt is the album's closing song, and one so beloved that Johnny Cash himself covered it before his passing. It's a complicated song to say the least, and not just because it has some of the strangest production on the entire record. The track sounding not only noisy and distorted, but as if it's glitching, having the levels of each instrument rise and fall inconsistently, some parts sounding clear and others obscured and distorted.
I hurt myself today to see if I still feel. I focus on the pain, the only thing that's real. The needle tears a hole, the old familiar sting. Try to kill it all away, but I remember everything.
To this day, the lyrics remain continuously debated by fans, with some seeing it as an allegory of a struggling addict, and others seeing it as a conclusion of the protagonist of the album, surviving his attempted suicide. I personally believe it's both. It's easy to see the use of guns and shooting as a metaphor for shooting heroin and attempting to overdose, hence the blue mushroom reference in the previous song, and this very well could be a reference to Alice in Wonderland, whose author Lewis Carroll was a heroin addict. Though with the context of the rest of the album and its violent imagery, it could also very well just be our protagonist surviving his brush with death. I personally see it as both, given the truly nihilistic and suicidal tendencies of the record, and multiple references to scabs and bruises, which are consistent with hard drug use. Trent himself was struggling with addiction at the time, and I'm sure anyone who has either gone through addiction themselves or had a loved one who did can contest. Many addicts become suicidal at rough points in their addiction, whether it's the apathetic acceptance that their vice will do them in, or outright attempts of taking their own life in order to escape their peril. Hurt is the perfect closer to the record, as it's a beautiful and haunting song, with lyrics that perfectly describe the feeling of being destroyed and letting those who love you down. I call The Downward Spiral an anti-nihilist album because that was the effect it had on me. The name itself perfectly describes the experience. The record musically and lyrically is a downward spiral into pure nihilism, self-hatred, and desperation, where we see someone go from simply not caring about the peril of their situation and the consequences of their self-destructive actions to crying for help until they finally give up and attempt to leave it all behind on their own terms. After listening to this record for the first time when I was 15, it made me never want to touch a hard drug in my life. It made me also think about just how stupid the, at the time, popular nihilism philosophy was, and reevaluate my own life in the process and the meaning that it held. Nihilism is a prison, and was even the topic of one of my first videos when I started making content for YouTube. Not to sound so preachy, but for most people, when you remove meaning from everything and accept that the world around you is pointless, it's hard to actually create your own meaning for it. And more often than not, we get sucked into hedonism and overindulgence as our coping mechanisms until they turn into addictions and mental prisons. But as I said, I don't want to make this video a pedestal to preach from. I already did an entire video on this, and I think the record speaks for itself. That being said, this is just my own interpretation of the record, and I'd love to hear what yours are in the comments. The Downward Spiral is an amazing album, and one of my all-time favorites, serving as a massive inspiration to me. If you haven't ever listened to it before, I hope this video has gotten you interested to dive into it, and Nine Inch Nails as a whole. With that being said, subscribe, support me on Patreon, follow me on Twitter. I'll see you in the next video.
It's me, Madison Rae. Play up your pathetic little babe pities.